Good morning. Wow, that was a hearty good morning. Welcome to Emmanuel. Welcome to those of you worshiping with us online. I'm Mindy Gochnauer, the pastor here, where we are seeking to build and grow relationships with the community in order to meet needs, proclaim the gospel, and develop faith. I have a bunch of announcements for you. We are gearing up for summer, which feels a little bit like fall, if I'm going to be honest. And we have lots of things coming up. So I wanted to draw your attention to a few of those things. First, I wanted to thank everyone who came out last week to our youth group open house. It was a fun time. It was a chaotic time. And it was great to see all of the kids there. So thank you for everyone who came and supported that event. In your bulletin, you will find this sheet that tells you the final numbers for egg making this year. Again, I want to thank all of you, especially the Bubs, for making the eggs happen here at Emmanuel. It's a very big opportunity to serve one another, to serve the community, and to raise some money for the church. I'm not going to read this for you because I will trust that you can read. If you can't, I'll help you after the service, but check this out. It'll share all of that information, and if you're worshiping with us online, we send that out via email. Coming up next Sunday after our second service at 11:30 will be our new members class. So if you are not a member of Emmanuel but you want to be, I encourage you to come and to hear what Emmanuel is all about. There is a sign-up sheet out here with a bunch of other sign-up sheets out on the sign-up board. I encourage you to walk this hallway and check all of that out. We will be having a summer yard sale on June the 22nd, which is a bring your own stuff. Great job, everyone. Bring your own stuff. Take your own stuff home. There are plenty of spots available both inside and outside. There's a sign-up sheet out here in the hallway if you are interested in reserving a spot. And you can talk to Patty Beasley if you have any questions about this event. We will be hosting our big indoor yard sale where you can bring your stuff and leave it here and you never have to see it again. That will be in November, and you can start bringing that stuff in at a later time that we will tell you, but not till fall. So don't leave it here because we're not ready for it just yet. We are looking for volunteers for both our soundboard and our PowerPoint. So if you are interested in serving during worship in this capacity, I encourage you to walk the hallway and check out the sign-up sheets. The PowerPoint is very simple. You don't have to prepare it. Simply sit at the PowerPoint area and press the button. And then our sound is a little more involved, but we're happy to show you and teach you the ropes of that. So if you would like to serve during worship in either of those capacities, please take a look at the sign-up sheets, and we'll be in contact with you. I will be offering a summer Bible study starting in June, the middle of June. I think the date is the 11th. This will be a morning Bible study at 10 a.m. on 1 Corinthians. If you're interested, there's the sign-up sheet for that. I encourage you to check that out. And also, the last thing I want to draw your attention to is that we would like to celebrate your graduates, anyone in your life that is graduating. We celebrate those graduates together, and so there is also a sign-up sheet for that, so that we get their name and school information correct, and that is also on the sign-up sheet board. So please let us know if you have a graduate that you would like us to celebrate this year. I want to extend a happy Mother's Day to all of the women in the room. We celebrate you this morning and the gift that you are to us. So good morning and welcome. Let us pray. Holy God, we give you thanks for our mothers. We give you thanks for the women that you have placed in our lives that love us, support us, and walk with us. God, we give you thanks for our church mothers. For the women who have loved us when we were growing up, for the women who loved us when we were difficult, for the women who have showed us what it means to love you, God, we are so grateful. And in our gratitude, we also recognize that this day can be really hard for some. So we ask, God, for your peace and comfort for the mothers who are struggling today. For those who are grieving the loss of a mother. For those who are grieving a relationship lost. God, we ask for your peace, for your healing, where there is tension in our relationships with our mothers. God, we know that above all, you are good. So even if this day is difficult, we know, God, that you are present. We know that you sit with us in the difficulty and in the celebration. So in all things, God, we give you thanks and we praise you this day for the women who show us what it means to follow faithfully after you. In your holy name we pray. Amen. As you're comfortably able, I invite you to stand and join us in the call to worship.
We gather together.
In the name of the one who bids us come.
We gather together.
To hear the words of the one who is love.
We gather together.
To sing praises of the one who teaches peace.
Come, let us worship. Let us join our voices together singing Amazing Grace, hymn number 378 in your hymnal.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me, his word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. Yea, when this flesh and heart shall fail, and mortal life shall cease, I shall possess within the veil a life of joy and peace. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun.
You may be seated. Let us join our voices together in the congregational hymn. Prayer. O God, we gather together in your presence with expectation, hungry for an encounter with you, eager to hear your word. Open our eyes and ears to the presence of your Holy Spirit. May the seeds of your word scattered among us this morning fall on fertile soil. May they take root in our hearts and lives and produce an abundant harvest of good words and deeds. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our teacher and our Lord. Amen. Now hear these words from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, verses 18 through 22. As Jesus was saying this, the leader of a synagogue came and knelt before him. "My daughter has just died," he said, "but you can bring her back to life again if you just come and lay your hand on her." So Jesus and the disciples got up and went with him. Just then, a woman who had suffered for 12 years with constant bleeding came up behind him. She touched the fringe of his robe, for she thought, "If I can just touch his robe, I will be healed." Jesus turned around, and when he saw her, he said, "Daughter, be encouraged. Your faith has made you well." And the woman was healed at that moment. Here ends the reading.
Try again. Ken didn't want to hear me preach this morning. Shaking his head no. See, I knew it. Last week, we started a new sermon series called Desperate, focusing on three different stories from Scripture that teach us what it means to be desperate for Jesus. Last week, we talked about the paralyzed man whose four friends were desperate to get him in front of Jesus for healing. We talked about how many of us are no longer desperate for Jesus and how we need to turn back to Jesus and start pursuing him each day. Today, we are focusing on the bleeding woman's desperation to touch just a piece of Jesus' robe. Let's pray. Holy God, may you continue to move among us and speak to our hearts this morning. In hearing your word, God, may we respond as your faithful people. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Years ago, a concert series started coming to the Bryce Jordan Center in State College called Winter Jam. If you aren't familiar with Winter Jam, it's a concert where multiple Christian bands and music artists perform a few of their songs. They bring in 10-plus bands, ranging from new artists to really popular ones. And the big draw is that it's only $10. $10. 10 bands for $10. That's how they would advertise it. The catch? You had to wait in line with thousands of other people to get a seat because there were no tickets sold in advance. For years, a group of friends of mine from my church would drive up midday to State College in the middle of January, and we would wait outside in the freezing cold because we were desperate to get floor seats for this concert. We would stand outside in lines for 5 to 6 hours just for a chance to get seats on the floor. It was kind of nutty as I look back on it. Facebook reminds me of it yearly. Pictures pop up, bundled up with blankets and hoods. But we were so desperate to guarantee that we would get the best seats in the house that we were willing to do anything to get them. And if it meant standing outside in the freezing temperatures for hours at a time, then that's what we would do. Desperation is a motivator. Sometimes it motivates us in a good way, and sometimes not so much. But whatever we are desperate for, it moves us to take action. Imagine believing Jesus had so much power that you are desperate to touch just a piece of his robe. We step into the story in Matthew this morning, into the middle of another story. The story that we didn't hear this morning involves the disciples of John the Baptist approaching Jesus to ask why he and his disciples don't fast like John the Baptist and the Pharisees. Jesus explains to the disciples of John the Baptist that while Jesus was among them, they didn't need to fast. He goes on to talk about doing things in a new way and bringing new life, instead of holding on to the old way. It is in that conversation that Jesus is interrupted by a synagogue leader, begging Jesus to come and to touch his daughter to bring her back to life. On his way to heal this girl, a bleeding woman approaches Jesus. This woman had been bleeding for 12 years. Can you imagine bleeding for 12 years? I can't handle bleeding for 12 seconds. Blood freaks me out. So I can't imagine living this way for 12 years and the desperation that this woman must have felt reaching out to touch Jesus. This woman was so desperate for healing that she believed touching just a piece of Jesus would give her what she had longed for. Desperation motivated the bleeding woman to take action, and it motivated the synagogue leader too. From a devotional entitled What Jesus Did, the author states, even though her outward circumstances and personal demeanor are the opposite of the synagogue ruler with whom she shares the story, their core issue is the same: faith that Jesus can deliver them from their desperate concerns. They both act in bold ways to find that deliverance. What does our faith look like? Do we trust that Jesus has power? Does our desperation motivate us to be in the presence of God? There are two stories of desperation here. One of the bleeding woman and one of the father desperate to save his daughter. And they both run to Jesus because they know what he is capable of. Are you running to Jesus because you believe that he has power? The bleeding woman didn't even need a face-to-face moment with Jesus. She knew at her core that if she could just touch him, she would be healed. She just needed a small piece of Jesus. What if we believed that just a piece of Jesus could bring hope and healing to us and to others? Sometimes we disqualify ourselves from sharing Jesus with others because we think we don't know enough. We don't feel smart enough. We haven't been following Jesus long enough. But if the hem of Jesus' robe can heal a bleeding woman of 12 years, and Jesus' touch can bring a girl back to life, then the little piece of Jesus that is giving you hope right now can change someone else's life. What if we were so desperate for Jesus, regardless of the size of our faith, that we lived each day as if Jesus had the power to change lives? How would your life look differently than it does right now if you were to live in this way? Fear often keeps us from being desperate for Jesus. Fear and excuses. And yet, if fear and excuses ruled the life of the bleeding woman and the synagogue leader, they never would have pursued reaching out to Jesus. Now, the bleeding woman would have been considered unclean in Jesus' day. She would have been isolated from others for 12 years. Can you imagine? Nobody would have wanted to be around her, especially not to touch her, for fear of being unclean too. The bleeding woman could have been ruled by fear and never reached out to touch Jesus. What if Jesus didn't want to heal her? What if Jesus didn't want to be associated with her, just like everyone else? But she didn't let those what-ifs and fears stop her from desperately reaching out to Jesus. And Jesus had no such concern. We know because he was on his way to touch a dead body, which also would have made Jesus unclean by law. But this father, the synagogue leader, was so desperate for healing, and Jesus didn't hesitate. You are not disqualified from being in the presence of Jesus. Lay down those fears today. It doesn't matter what you've done or where you've been. You are not too dirty, too poor, too broken, too jaded, too scarred for Jesus. You haven't made too many mistakes. Your brokenness does not keep Jesus from wanting to be in relationship with you. So run desperately towards him. As we reflect on this powerful story, it seems kind of odd, doesn't it? That this bleeding woman would want to touch Jesus for a positive change in her life. That the synagogue leader would ask Jesus to touch a dead body for a positive change. But think of all of the things that we touch that matter. When we long for a hug on a tough day, or we grab a blanket when we need comfort. Or, some crazier things, what about people who want to kiss the Blarney Stone in Ireland because they believe that it's good luck or that they will have eloquent speech? You laugh because you know it's crazy. Maybe you've done it. What about the man from Scripture who tried to get in the fountain to be healed because he knew if he could touch the water, he would be healed? Or what about, maybe even some of you do this, those special items we hold on to during sports things, events, that's what they're called, games. Clearly, I don't have them. Because we believe that if we just don't wash those dirty socks and we hold on to them, our team will win. Right? It's crazy. We do it. We believe that touching things will bring about a positive change in our lives. Are you desperate to reach out for Jesus? Are you desperate for others to be touched by him? This bleeding woman and the father of the girl who died knew touching Jesus or a touch from Jesus would change their lives. Do we believe that Jesus can still do that? I do. I still believe in the power of Jesus. I believe that God is still healing. I believe that the name of Jesus is still powerful. I believe the Holy Spirit still works in our lives to bring about change. I believe that people still want to know about the life-changing power of Jesus. Nobody else had to believe. The bleeding woman didn't need the people around her to believe Jesus could heal her. Their opinion didn't matter. The synagogue leader didn't need anyone else to believe that Jesus could heal his daughter. Their opinions didn't matter because he believed. People around you may not be desperate for Jesus. They may even laugh, judge, or distance themselves from you. If you know the power that Jesus holds, why does it matter what others think, say, or believe? We have to stop giving other people so much power over us. The power of Jesus is the power that matters. So how has Jesus touched your life? What impact is he making? How is this power affecting you and those around you? You don't have to have it all together, church. You don't have to be the most knowledgeable person in the room. Don't let any excuse or fear keep you from being desperate for Jesus. Those around you don't have to believe in the power of Jesus for you to believe it. Run to Jesus in desperation, believing that just a piece of Jesus still holds power. Let us pray. Holy God, we call upon your name because we know that it still has power. We trust, God, that you are still alive and at work in us and in the world. Sometimes, God, we get distracted by the world. We get distracted by the busyness of our lives, by all of the things that we need to do, and we forget about your power. But God, deep in our hearts, we know that you are still moving. We see it when we're looking for it, your hand in the world. So God, open our eyes up to the movement of your Spirit among us. May we be desperate to be in your presence, that we would live each and every day faithfully following after you. And God, because we believe in your power, because we believe that you are still moving, that you are still healing, this morning we lay before you our greatest concerns. And we continue to pray for Susie Herzog, and we ask, God, that you would continue to pour out your healing upon her as you have already done. God, we lift up Emma Bohr this morning. And we ask, God, that your healing touch would be upon her as she is in pain this day. May she feel your presence and your peace surrounding her. God, we lift up Kathy Stone's Aunt Charlotte, who had a stroke and is now in rehab. We ask, God, for your continued healing to be upon her and that you would restore her body. God, we lift up the friend of Kay Barrett, Beth, who was in the hospital, and we ask, God, that you would be with Beth and that you would surround her with your healing touch. God, we lift up all of those who are suffering, who are struggling, who are suffering alone. And God, we lift them to you because we believe that you hear and you see. And you know what we need. So we lay all of these needs down before you, trusting, God, that you will move as you've done before and you will continue to do. And so together as your people, we join our voices to pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And so, church, you know that we are called not to just hear the word, to faithfully respond to it. And so I urge you this week to spend time in the presence of God. Spend some time in prayer. Put Jesus' words into action in your life. Also invite you this morning to give as you feel led to do so. And you can give of your tithes and offerings online, or as you leave, you'll find an offering plate in the back. And as we contemplate how we might respond to God this morning, I invite you to stand as you are able to join in singing the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Holy God. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for providing for what we need. Thank you for the many blessings that we experience in our lives each and every day. And so, God, as an act of faith, as an act of gratitude here and now, we offer but a piece of what we have, and we offer it back to you. May you pour out your blessing upon our tithes and our gifts and our offerings. In all things, may we honor and glorify you. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Friends, will you stay standing to join together our voices in song, singing our closing hymn? It's number 77 in your hymnal if you like to follow along. It's How Great Thou Art.
O Lord, my God, awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul. Burden brought. Christ shall come.
Go this day. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, being desperate for just a piece of Jesus, go in peace. Amen.
Shalom to you now. Shalom, my friends. May God's full mercy bless you, my friends, in all your living and through your loving. Christ be your shalom. Christ be your shalom.